Okay, let's reassemble back. I hope all of you have finished tea and come back into your centers. And let us now continue with this activity. Where we had stopped before tea is we were exploring this question, what is in a research study? Before that, we had looked at what are not some features of a research, or what are some features that should not be there, or what is not a research study. And now we are looking at what exactly should be in a research study. And what you were going to do is recall the lesson plan that you wrote yesterday, specifically what you would do and what your students would do. And you were going to write down what you expect to see in terms of statements like, I think my idea will be successful if I find that my students are doing something, feeling something, or if I am doing something and I am feeling something, and so on. So I'll just give you one more minute to write this if you haven't done so yet, and then we'll move to the pair phase. Only write these answers in your own notebook individually. Okay, now what you can do is pair up with your neighbor and look at your neighbor's answers and do two things. One is suggest more statements that your neighbor could add to her or his answer that might indicate success of the idea. And most importantly, together, select any two statements. So you should have four or more than four statements. Your neighbor will have an equal number of statements. So select any two statements and determine how you will measure the extent of success. If some idea that you wrote on the previous slide, if these are not measurable, you can go back and change these. But we are now getting towards a more systematic scientific data collection and evidence procedure. I'll give you an example of what is not measurable. If you said something that my students are feeling happy, that's really not a measurable quantity. If you say something that my students are doing well, it's not precise enough to be measurable. So first write down statements and then select any two statements which have some measurableness and write down, determine how you will measure the extent of the success. So take some time. This is the most important part of trying to write down your research questions. So do this carefully and then we'll go to the next phase. So let's take about 5 minutes, 5 to 7 minutes to do this phase. I'm just going to put the previous slide because some people have asked to see this slide. So this was the think phase, this was the pair phase. And in the share phase, what you can do when you're ready is share your answer with your colleagues. So I'd request all the RC coordinators to actually do an in-class discussion at this point. And only then share the most common answer through AVU chat. So in your RCs, discuss what is to be measured and how it is to be measured. Let's look at a range of answers. So please do this discussion for 3 or 4 minutes and only then post your answers. Not just what is to be measured, but what and how. If you send answers like, my idea works if I feel good, that's not measurable. So remember, this is the most important part. Select any two statements that are measurable and determine how you will measure the extent of success. Okay, it looks like many of you are sending reasonable answers about what is to be measured, but the how is still not coming through precisely. So let me give you a few examples. One of you say that, I think my idea will work if I am able to lead the discussion to a higher cognitive level. Now, okay, you may be able to do it, but how will you measure and report that in a research study? So when you think about how to measure, what you have to do is try to see what data you will collect. What will you measure? How will you actually go about doing the measurement? So some of you have said that I'm going to do pre-test and post-test. We want measurement metrics like students, at least 80% of the students should do the assignment with an average of 80% or greater. Similarly, some of you have said you'll measure students' attendance and performance in midterm. That's also okay. What will you measure? Let me read a few others. So many of you are looking at students' performance on tests. That is definitely one possible metric. How many students are able to solve problems in different levels of Bloom's taxonomy? That is definitely one measurement that you can use. And what their metric for what to measure was students' ability to solve higher order problems. So try to be specific. Don't just say I'm going to look at their final exam marks. Let me look at a couple of other interesting points. If you say that you want to, you know your idea works, if students are confident, you have to find a way to determine how to measure the confidence. Yeah, I would say the most common answer is students' performance in tests and exams, but you need to get more specific. So I think let's move on and try to look at specific research questions that you can write. Okay, so if you can stop sending your responses and let's look at how researchers have actually attempted this problem. You will get a chance to come back and refine these metrics as we go on in this session. So, a research study must contain what is called research questions. After you do the analysis of related work and find out gaps and try to identify where your study fits the gaps, you now have to start writing research questions for your study, which are actually issues that you will investigate. So, a research study contains the research questions and its answers accompanied by evidence. For example, if you have identified a specific teaching learning problem, such as students' ability to solve higher order cognitive tasks, then the research question should be about how well does your solution address the problem. So let's look at some examples at this point. So please stop sending your responses through chat, because we'll now go beyond exams, we'll go beyond students' performance in exams. And try to write down research questions which you can actually put in a paper, which you can use as a research question for a study. So, a research question should have certain characteristics. It should express a relation between variables, two or more, in specific contexts. So, are animations effective is not a valid research question, because even though it talks about animations and effectiveness, it's not at all specific. So we'll see what are not research questions and then we'll see how to write a good research question. The second point of a research question is that it should be stated clearly in the form of a question, not as a statement. So you should not say that the purpose of my study is to gather data to support my idea of showing animations. That is not a research question. That is one of the steps you will do in your research study. And finally, a research question, this is sort of the most important point that we also talked about in the Think, Pair, Share activity. A research question should imply possibilities of empirical testing. There should be a possibility that you do an experiment, gather data, analyze the data, make inferences, and draw conclusions. If that possibility doesn't exist, then the question is not worded correctly. So, should one use animations in primary schools is not a research question, because it's not possible to answer this question should using empirical data. Should usually implies something very moral and very opinionated and judgmental. So, a good research question would be something like, are animations more effective than still visuals for conceptual understanding of electromagnetic fields? This is just one example. So let's see if it satisfies all these criteria. Does this question express a relation between variables? So there is a variable of the mode of visuals. Animations and still visuals are two values of this variable. That's one variable. And effectiveness in terms of conceptual understanding is another variable. Is there a specific context? In this question, yes. It's conceptual understanding of electromagnetic fields. Is it stated clearly in question form? Definitely. It poses a question, which of the two methods is better for that context? And finally, is it possible to do a study, an experiment, an empirical study to test this? Well, it is possible if you think about it. Some students can work with animations, others can learn using still visuals, and you can do some testing in terms of conceptual understanding of electromagnetic fields. So the question itself should tell you how to perform your empirical study. So once you have seen the features of a research question, let's now look at three different examples of actual research questions in published papers in educational technology. And once we see the examples, we'll go back to your example and you'll rewrite your think pair share question. But first, let's see three examples of RQs and let's actually try to look at whether these characteristics of a research questions are present. So this is the same abstract that you saw earlier when you were looking at novelty and positioning. If you want, you can read it again and then look at the research question. There were one or two other questions, but I've just included one question here. It's the same example that you worked on the TPS. The question is, does a 3-hour blender training, which was the novel solution, does a 3-hour blender training improve the mental rotation ability of first year undergraduate engineering students? So if you notice, the teaching learning problem that this paper was trying to solve was the improvement of mental rotation ability. In fact, they even say in the first line why that ability is important. Then what they do is they did the positioning. They talked about existing approaches and their approach. We developed a 3-hour training module. The research question they ask at that point is, does this intervention of ours, does the solution idea of ours indeed improve mental rotation ability for a very specific population? So your research questions really have to get as detailed and specific like the one here. So I'll show you one more example that's related to think pair share, and since you know the technique, you might appreciate it. Again, there is an abstract and there are two research questions. So I'll give you 3 or 4 minutes to read this. So this was another research paper about think pair share in a large CS1 programming class. And what the researchers were trying to investigate is, does learning really happen using think pair share? So take a minute, read these, and then we'll look at the research questions. So in this study, the authors asked two research questions. One is, do TPS activities lead to increased conceptual understanding and application of programming concepts? So again, there are two variables which are being measured. One is the implementation of TPS and the other is the conceptual understanding as well as application. They pose it as a question, and this definitely can be experimentally investigated. So that's the point you want to try to see. How is it possible to do an experiment here? The abstract tells you. So what they did is what's called a quasi-experimental study. What that means is that there were two groups. One group was taught using TPS and one group was taught without TPS. And what they found is that students who learned via TPS performed statistically significantly better on a post-test than students who learned the same concept via lecture. So they did an actual experiment, TPS versus no TPS, and measured through a post-test conceptual understanding and programming. They had one more research question here. They wanted to find out what are students' own perceptions of learning. How did students feel about learning via TPS? So for that, they designed a survey and a focus group interview to understand student perceptions. And they found that majority students agreed that TPS activities helped improve their understanding. They did not ask the students, did you like TPS? But they specifically asked the students, did you find that TPS helped you, that TPS helped improve your conceptual understanding and application? One last example. Here I'm not showing you an abstract, but I just want to show you three research questions. And the study that these people did was about showing visualization. So this is a topic we dealt with in great detail yesterday, about simply demonstrating visualizations and doing some activity along with visualizations. So these researchers actually performed a study where one group learned only by viewing the visualizations. This was also a computer programming course. Another group viewed the visualizations and did a predict, observe, correct kind of activity, exactly the kinds that you did yesterday. And the questions they asked was, does prediction activity with visualization lead to higher levels of learning than simply viewing the visualization? So they are contrasting two conditions. One is prediction plus visualization and one is simply viewing. They also ask about student perceptions about learning, and now they get a little bit more into detail. They ask about differences in learning and perceptions between high achieving students compared to low achieving students. So what you can do in your own research studies is ask broad questions like, did the method work for the class? Did it help improve problem solving ability? And in addition, you can also try to investigate specifically for whom it worked better. Did it help the high achievers more or did it help the low achievers more? Did it help the more motivated students or the less motivated students? These are all important specific things that you can actually investigate in a research study. So there's a chat question at this time which says how to measure students' perceptions. So we'll come to that in a few slides. We are still looking at the questions themselves, how to write meaningful, valid questions. We will discuss how to measure perceptions and we will also discuss how to measure these different levels of learning. And exams are not, they're not the best way to measure learning. Okay, so here is a very interesting question from Walchand Institute, that if many people are using TPS in CS or other domains, will it be considered to be novel? And I think they are asking about this particular question. This is an important question because now if you, when this paper was written, they found that there was a lack of research-based evidence in CS education on the benefits of TPS. But since then, about 3 papers have been published on using TPS in a large, in computer science domain classes. So if you want to apply TPS to a computer science class, you have to find a new angle to your research study. For example, you can ask the question, does TPS help low achievers more or high achievers more? Because these people have not looked at it from that angle. But if you simply replicate TPS in another programming or data structures course, you will find that there already exists research. So it's not going to be considered as novel. So this is the game, because once people start thinking and doing studies on a particular topic, a lot of people will work on it. So to establish novelty, you have to find a new angle to the same problem. That is valid. You can perhaps ask, how long should be each phase so that the phases are effective? You can ask what happens in the pair phase to make it effective and so on. So look for angles that are not there in the existing papers. Okay, so let's now go back to your own activity. And let's do this as a fastest finger first or a brain race, what we call. So participants, revisit your answer to the TPS activity which you did about 15 minutes ago and write one research question for your research study. Pass along your answer to coordinator, and coordinators, please do 2 things. If it is not phrased as a question, if it's a goal statement or if it's a should I do this statement, disqualify that question. If you send us RQs that are not phrased as questions or that are phrased as should I do this questions, then we'll disqualify the question at our end. And the first valid RQ, please convey through the AVU chat. So go back to your research study and the TPS activity that you did at the beginning of this session. and rewrite it as an RQ. I'm going to put back the slide as to, just for 30 seconds, what is an RQ. It has relationships between variables in specific context, stated in question format, and must imply possibilities of empirical testing. This was a valid RQ here. So now, go to your question, your study. You can go back to your lesson plan idea and write one research question from your lesson plan idea. Please do this activity now. We will come to how to measure student perception and all after some time. Look at your lesson plan and write RQs based on your own lesson plan. Okay, so let's look at a few questions that you have sent. I'm going to comment on some of these questions because I think you're all getting to some point. So let's look at one question. It says, does flipped classroom activity enable conceptual understanding of equilibrium of force system among students? So again, it may be a valid question in terms of measurement, but what you have to be sure of is in what way this approach is novel and why flipped classroom is so important for forces, for the topic that you are thinking. Let me look at a few other questions. Some of you have asked, does visualization with prediction of output in programming language improve students' ability to write programs? That's actually a valid question. It can be measured. It's in fact, you will see other studies like this. So you have to be a little careful in terms of positioning, but it's specific enough to be a valid RQ because you are actually giving the idea is very precise. Visualization with prediction of output in a programming class. And what is being measured is students' programming ability. On the other hand, if you ask a question such as, do rubrics improve student performance in computer science? It's too broad. You have to say rubrics for what? It's not, computer science domain is too vast, and just rubrics in of itself, you won't be able to do a study which encompasses all of computer science domains. Here is a question which may be valid. What is the impact of TPS on low achieving students? Actually, you can try to investigate that within a specific topic. Then it will become a valid question. Okay, here is a question. What is the impact on student engagement of combining animation with TPS? So this is something we haven't seen yet among the answers that you've already given. The researchers want to study student engagement from two perspectives, animation combined with TPS. And they'll have to find ways to measure engagement. We'll come to that in a minute, how to measure things. But you want to now start thinking in terms of what are the various things you can measure. Okay, let me take a couple of doubts here. So I'm going to stop looking at your own research questions that you are sending, and instead I'm going to look at a couple of doubts. One doubt that was asked in the beginning of the session was, can a teaching strategy effect vary from subject to subject, from student to student? And if so, how can it be a research question? Can we compare one student against the other? So your point is valid that a teaching strategy may have a differential effect on one student than another student. But what you're doing in a research study is actually looking at averages. Just like in a science experiment, you take multiple data points, but finally when you do the analysis, you look at averages and medians, you look at the range. So it's something very similar here. You can look at average over your entire class, or you can divide your class into low, medium, high achievers based on previous year's marks, and look at averages in each of these categories. Usually we don't look at one student versus another student, but we look at averages over groups of similar students. You can look at one section which is taught in one method, average of one entire section versus average of one entire other section, which is taught using a different method. So most of the times you're dealing with averages over an entire set of participants. The other doubt that was asked is it mandatory for us to develop a research study in the ET field, I would like to be user only. And this is perfectly valid. If you only want to be a user of ET strategies, please do go ahead, encourage you to use it. This session is if you want to take things one step ahead for all the benefits that we discussed in the beginning, then here are some systematic techniques to do so. If you choose to be a user, definitely stay there, but even then it would help if you can gather some evidence using these methods that we are discussing now. Because the moment you have evidence, you can discuss it with the head of your department or with the principal of your college, saying that I implemented a new technique using ICT and I also gathered evidence to show that it works from angle of student engagement or student learning. It doesn't have to become a research study or research paper, but just the evidence and the inferences often make your case very strong. Okay, let's go on a little bit more now and actually look at another metric which is important in your research study. So now we have an idea of how to write research questions. We have two more things to do. One is, how do we implement the research study? How do we conduct it? And the next one is, how do we actually do the measurements? So in terms of the procedure, there is a metric or there is a criterion that your research study and paper must have. Just like novelty and positioning, it should have what we call a soundness. What is soundness? It's essentially steps to show that you've implemented your solution carefully. Because like any scientific experiment, if your steps are not implemented carefully, then it ceases to be valid. The inferences will not be considered to be strong. So let's look at one or two examples of soundness here. And here is an activity, quick activity. Just say yes or no in the chat. Suppose you implement the following method. You or your colleague has implemented a method where the first step is you implement an innovative strategy. I'm going to call this as strategy X. You then conduct a test to check if students have done well after learning with strategy X. And you claim that since students did well on the test, assume all students, many students did well on the test. Okay, make that assumption. You claim that the strategy X works. So suppose you implement a research study and write a research paper like this. Does this method establish that strategy X really works? It's a simple yes-no question. Many of you are saying yes. Some are saying no. Okay, so from the votes, it seems like about 80% of you think that these steps show that method X, strategy X actually works. If you write a paper like this, let me tell you the answer. The referee decision will say that paper is rejected and they'll say that the method is not sound enough to establish the claim. So if these are the only steps you implement, these steps are not sufficient to establish that your strategy, your innovative strategy actually works. This kind of a method is called a single group post-test only design. What it means is that you have one group of students for which you have implemented strategy X. You do a test at the end. That's why it's called post-test, and that's your research design. So here is the next question for you. Do this as a pair activity and you can send us the answers over chat. Why is this research design not sound? Not sound in the sense, if you implement these steps, why is this research considered to be not sufficient to establish that strategy X actually works? So in pairs, come up with one reasons why the above steps of research are not a good method yet to establish that strategy X is effective. What's wrong in this? Assume that you give a really good test. And assume that your students actually do well on the test. Your test does have questions on application and analysis, and students actually do well, but still this is not a good enough method. Okay, some of you are getting the idea. Okay, I think most of you are getting the idea here. To summarize, like one of you said, there can be many other reasons other than strategy X which led to high scores on the test. So let's look at what are the problems here for if you do a single group post-test only research. The outcome, that is the result, could have occurred due to a reason that's other than the treatment, some completely other reason. And you won't know if it's due to your strategy X that you got a good result or some other reason, because there is no comparison to a group that did not receive the treatment. The result could have existed even before you did your strategy X. Treatment means what you implement in class, the intervention, your solution. You never tested the students before you implemented the strategy, so maybe they already knew the results. And you have no control over all other influences. Maybe they went and watched a YouTube video. Maybe they talked to each other. So you don't know why exactly you are seeing positive results. So if you do something like implement an innovative strategy, do one test at the end, that is not sufficient to establish that your innovative strategy works. So in order to have a sound method, you have to do one of two things. The problem that there is no comparison to a group that did not receive the statement can be solved if you can compare results of your method, your strategy, to some group of students that did not work with your strategy. This is a two-group comparison. It's sometimes called a controlled group experiment. This is what is called as a quasi-experiment that we saw. We saw those words a few slides ago. So if possible, in your class, if you can compare one group of students, let's say you have two sections, let one group work with visualization plus prediction and let the other group work with demo of visualization for one topic. For another topic, you can reverse the order so that you are being fair. So see if you can do a comparison to some other group. Suppose that's not possible, there is one more thing you can do. You can, if you only have one group, you can compare the performance of the group before and after the treatment. This is called a pre-post test design. It's not as strong as the previous one, but it's still better than the post only design. So after a single test, you can't claim that the strategy was successful because of all these problems. And the solutions you would implement, possible solutions, are here. Okay, so this is one way of ensuring that you have soundness in your procedure of research. There are some other ways. If you cannot get two groups at all, one possible thing you can do is implement your solution for one topic. Let's say you only have one section and you can't do two groups. What do you do then? You implement your new innovative solution for one topic, and in a completely unrelated topic for the same group of students, you can implement the other method and repeat this a couple of times. So that is called an ABAB design. So there are several ways to implement research, and these go under the names of research designs. Today we'll only talk briefly about it. If you choose to continue doing research in this field, then we'll show you, we'll give you more resources and more references as to how you can implement these different research designs. The final thing that you want to be careful about, that your research study and paper should have, is something that all of you have already discussed. You need evidence to support your claims. Claims are the conclusions that you draw from your research. So you need data to show that your solution works as claimed, which means what you have to do is decide what to measure in your study, which you'll show as evidence, and the data that you gather should really be aligned with the goal of your study. So if your initial goal was to improve student learning, the data you gather should be related to student learning. If you gather data about did students like my strategy, then your goal should have been something like student interest. Match your research goal, which was there in the research questions, with the type of data that you gather. So let's go back to our example of mental rotation and see if that example has these two points, soundness of procedure and evidence to support claims. So I'm going to put back that abstract and let's see where in the abstract we see that the researchers have implemented a sound research procedure and shown evidence to support the claims. Let's take a look at those two. So in this abstract, you can see that towards the bottom, they said that they use something called a Vandenberg's mental rotation test for pre-test and post-test. So they have implemented a pre-post-test design. Not only that, they've chosen to measure mental rotation using an already established test that also shows soundness. Then they did an analysis, a detailed analysis, and found the results to be statistically significant. There are tests, statistical tests that you have to do. You can't simply say that my students learned well. So let's say your student's average was 75%. How will you conclude that 75% means good? You have to do some statistical tests between the pre and post. Some of these are, you may have heard the terms like t-test or chi-square test. Those are all different statistical tests that you have to do. And your results must be significant on statistical samples of the averages. And then you can also measure something called effect sizes. So all you can see from here, I know you may not understand exactly what these mean, but the purpose of this example is to show you that you have to actually come up with precise quantitative analysis to show evidence in support of your claim. Only after these evidences do these authors claim their method of blender 3D training works for improving mental rotation. Okay, so in your case, now let's look at what to measure. So we'll come to the final part of this session, and many of you have been asking, what should I measure and how should I measure different things? So let's take a look here. So typically, technology enhanced learning metrics can have different goals, and you should focus on one or two of these. Please don't attempt all these metrics. And these are in order of usually what teachers are interested in. You can choose to measure students' improvement of learning of concepts of skills or skills. This usually goes under the name of effectiveness. This is the learning outcomes that we've been discussing so far. Or you can choose to measure what's called attractiveness, which is students' engagement, motivation, interest, confidence, and so on. You can also choose to measure something like how your solution scales to larger contexts or different types of learners. I'm not very sure if many of you are in this category, but there is a possibility that your research study might simply be to show that the technology enhanced learning solution that you have developed, the goal might be to scale to larger numbers. So if you are working in online education, scaling is one of the important metrics. If you're mostly doing face-to-face, then most likely your metrics are going to be the first or the second. And finally, for universities and institutes and colleges, they may want to measure efficiency in terms of saving time or money or resources. As individual faculty members, this is perhaps not the most advisable metric. So I've put these on the slide to show what are different metrics that people use to measure effectiveness. But I would suggest that you concentrate on the first and second. Don't attempt too many of it. So, one quick polling activity at this point. Remember the research question that you wrote for your lesson plan idea some time ago? So, revisit your research question and simply say, which technology enhanced learning metric did it correspond to best? Improving learning, enhancing engagement, scaling, or saving time. So just vote on your question. Is your question related to learning effectiveness or engagement? And let's look at what percentage of people had which category. Actually, let me do one thing. Let me just create a quick poll. It will be interesting to see. I'm just going to create a poll. Send it on poll. Let's take a look at the percentages. Okay, out of 110 centers, it looks like about 70 centers have learning effectiveness as your major metric. There's no right or wrong answer. This is more to see what you're doing. About 20 centers say that engagement, interest, etc. is the major, is the main metric. And a similar number says scaling. I'm not sure because I didn't see any research question that you said related to scaling. So let me just quickly explain what this is. Let's say that the reason for you to implement some technology-based solution is to reach out to larger numbers. So for example, if you use chat forums in Moodle, in order to get larger number of students to participate, that you can consider, perhaps you can consider to be scaling, but that also indicates engagement. So if you say that your answer is scaling, I would ask you to revisit your question a little more carefully. I'll give you one example of scaling. This workshop that you're seeing, ET for ET, which is being done on, under the Teach 10,000 Teachers platform, the major goal for this workshop is scaling. We've done a number of face-to-face workshops like this, but in a face-to-face workshop, we can address maybe 50 or not, no more than 100 participants. But because of our technology-enhanced environment, AVU and poll and interactive chat and the two-way audio-video, we are able to reach out to 4,000 participants. So our goal here is scaling. It's also learning and engagement. But in a classroom, most likely your goal is going to be either learning or engagement or some mixture of the two. Okay, so let's go back to the slides and look at the metrics a little bit more. And now ask the question, how do we measure? How do we measure learning and how do we measure engagement? So for learning, tests are commonly used instrument for measuring effectiveness and learning. And let's look at some do's and don'ts for tests and then we'll come back to survey questionnaires. So if your goal is learning effectiveness, you need evidence. This is an important slide. So I request all of you to pay attention here. If your metric is effectiveness of learning, then the evidence that you need is improvement of learning of a specific concept or skill. The data you need to collect is performance on a test related to that concept, either before and after or in a two-group manner. But you have to make sure that the performance, that the test should be related to the concept, the specific concept whose learning you're trying to improve. What you should not do is give a typical final exam question which has only recall and describe questions. What you can do is sometimes there are standardized tests available for a particular concept. So for example, for C programming or for forces in physics, there exists tests. These are called instruments and concept inventories, which actually have conceptual and reasoning questions related to that concept. If your improvement is understanding of forces, then the questions in your test should have forces, maybe make students draw diagrams and so on. On the other hand, suppose your metric is improvement of learning of a specific skill such as programming ability. Then what data you should collect is performance on an actual programming or debugging question. You have to make students write a program or debug a program in order to gather evidence that their programming ability improved. If you only give a question about programming concepts, such as what is a variable or is this a valid pointer, it doesn't precisely test programming ability. So how to measure this? Ask students to write a program to solve a problem. Or give a buggy program and ask students to debug the code till it gives the desired output. So you have to measure specifically what the type of data you want to collect. Do not ask recall or understand level questions asking what's a variable. This is not sound research for improving skill. In your analysis, what you can do here is analyze the number of errors that students make in the program and classify them as syntax and logical errors. That will give you an idea of students' programming ability. So going back to what to measure, tests are commonly used instruments for measuring learning of skill or concepts, but you have to make sure that you measure, that that your tests actually specifically ask questions related to that concept of skin. Let's look at the next category. If you want to measure students' engagement, motivation, confidence, and so on, typically we give questionnaires or surveys. And again, there are some do's and don'ts. So if you want to measure student engagement, you need to collect data of students' perception of their interest. And for that, you can give questionnaires. Should you develop the questionnaire? Well, if you can find existing validated questionnaires, please use those. Why I'm stressing this is, let's say you're doing an engineering experiment. You try to find instruments that already exist and that have already been calibrated. Only if you can't find existing instruments do you do your own instrumentation. That's the analogy here. If you have to do your own instrumentation, you have to first validate it, you have to test that it's robust and reliable, you have to calibrate it, and there are several steps to building an instrument before you can gather data. So, see if you can find existing surveys and questionnaires for student engagement. If so, use those. There exist many on student interest, student engagement, students' attitudes, confidence, and so on. If you cannot find and if you have to build your own, then we'll see what to do. Other data you can collect for student engagement is their attendance, their participation rates in different assignments, how much time do they spend on task, how many of them participate in extra credit activities. All those are valid ways to measure student engagement. Going back to surveys, if you have to construct your own perception surveys and questionnaires, don't simply ask, did you like or dislike it? Because that is not going to give you fine-grained enough evidence. Instead, ask questions related to what you really want to measure. So you can ask students, how much did you learn on a scale of 1 to 5? Very much, not so much, or not at all? Use scales or ratings like the one that I just mentioned. Don't ask a single question, is the method interesting, because that's not very reliable. Instead, ask many specific questions related to what you want to measure. So going back to how to measure different things, we have discussed a little bit about how do you measure learning and how do you measure engagement. There are several other methods. They go by the name of focus group interviews, observation protocols, and other instruments. These are beyond the scope of this workshop, but if you're still interested in it, I'll discuss what to do in a few minutes. So what we can do at this point is summarize what we have seen so far. So in this session, the key points, we first discussed a lot about what is not ET research. And then we looked at some specific features of ET research, identifying research questions, using established technology enhanced metrics, gathering data using appropriate instruments, novelty, positioning, soundness, evidence. So all those are features of ET research. And to help you go beyond routine implementation, many times novice researchers in ET ask us, so how do I do all this? You know, how do I learn about all this? One of the first steps is you have to start reading research papers. And what you can do for that is we will upload an assignment in Moodle. So what next now? We are going to upload an assignment by tomorrow. This is a voluntary assignment. If you want to go ahead with ET research, we will post a research paper. And we will ask you questions related to that research paper and related to your own research study. So doing this assignment, reading as well as reviewing your own research study, is one way to gather more expertise in doing ET research. This is a voluntary assignment, but we'd encourage a lot of you to do it, because if you do it, you can also gather evidence for your own idea, even if you don't want to write a research paper. What next? Part 2. If you want to go one step further in executing the idea, and if you want to complete your research study, gather data from your own class, from your own students, what I would ask you all to do is register on this forum. We are going to create a forum called Mission 2015. Here, you will have other participants who are doing research in this area, and you will also have mentors present who can help you with this research idea. Eventually, if you want, you can also submit a research paper to the IEEE conference called Technology for Education. I mentioned this at the beginning. At least you should attend it and see what are the other kinds of research ideas that people submit and publish. What we will do from our end, if you decide to go all this way, is provide mentoring for executing the research study, data collection, analysis, and so on. But first, you have to, if you want to get the mentoring, you have to do the homework, and then you have to register on this forum. To make your life, to help you through this entire process, what we have created is a set of templates on our research website. So, your research study actually has several phases: planning, conducting, reporting, and so on. So, for each stage, we have created templates called idea proposal template, study planning template, and then when you get to the reporting, there are other templates called paper planning and paper writing. You're nowhere along here yet. Right now, you're really somewhere near the idea proposal, and we hope you will get to the study planning. These templates are available on our website, ET Resources. There are some other guidelines if you want to do these studies and do these resources, use these resources. So eventually, whether you choose to do a research study and whether you choose to go all the way here, or you just want to gather some evidence, I would encourage you to go to this webpage, look at the guidelines, look at the resources so that you can bring closure to your research study. So what we'll do right now is end the session formally here. And if you have questions in your from your centers, you can do a hand raise, and we'll start taking questions one by one for the next 25 minutes. Center 1166, is there a question?
I had one research question in my mind. Yeah. Can we go for predicting the students' scores for their online, for their ongoing semesters through these newer teaching learning pedagogies? Because at times we try to find out the ones who are not able to grasp much. Mm-hmm. And from my end, I think sometimes it's better to go for makeup classes and remedial actions for these students.
Okay.
Can you suggest some methods?
Okay. So the question here, it's actually an interesting question. And let's discuss whether you want to do it as a research study or more in order to improve your own practice. The question, can we predict students' performance based on how they do in these activities? And before you get to prediction, what I would suggest is you try to gather data and start looking for patterns and correlations. So people do research of this kind, and some examples are, let's say you give peer instruction questions, multiple choice peer instruction questions, where you have very carefully worded choices. If you can find a way to keep data of which students are answering which choice, and let's say the same group of students, let's say there are two students who are always giving the wrong conceptual answer, you know that they are having some difficulty in terms of that particular concept, or maybe through the entire course. If you are able to identify such students, you can definitely conduct additional classes for them, or talk to them, give them some extra work, and so on. So definitely you can use these in-class active learning strategies as feedback for you as an instructor on who's doing well and who's not. Now, where it becomes a challenge is how do you collect this data and how do you track these students, how do you gather data. So there, if you have access to technology, that's one place you can do it. The other thing you can do is, let's say you have a think pair share activity, get students to write on worksheet think phase and pair phase and give it back to you. So based on the quick analysis, you're not really grading them in great detail, but you're trying to filter who's really having trouble. And these quick worksheets that you do in class, or predictions that students can do and write it on a piece of paper and hand it in, those can help you track who's understanding and who's not. So definitely this is a very important, interesting point you bring up, that you use these active learning strategies as feedback for yourself. And right in the beginning of the session, we use the words action research. This is action research, where you gather data and improve your own practice in order to improve the total teaching learning experience.
There is one more question from my colleague, madam. Ma'am, is think pair share is more effective than visualization in a classroom for numerical problems and numerical subjects?
Okay, so let me repeat the question and try to answer a class of questions. So the specific question here is think pair share a better method than visualization for numerical problems? Anytime you ask a question, is method A better than method B, you have to really go much more specific. The answer is, I don't know, and there is no answer for this. So how will you decide? Look at the purpose for which you want to use either think pair share or visualization. Look at the learning objectives. Look at what you want your students to be able to do. For every active learning strategy and for every technology tool, we discussed in great detail the purpose of using the technology. What are its benefits? And if those benefits match the needs that you have, then it is a good method. Perhaps you choose to merge think pair share with a visualization. We had one colleague who did this. She had students view visualizations on convolution of signals. This was in a signals and systems course. Then she gave a think pair share activity where students actually convolved the signals and did the signal transformations. Or you can merge a visualization with a peer instruction. But don't ask blanket questions about is method A better than method B, because it really depends on what you choose, what you want to achieve. Okay, so let's go back and take a question from Amal Jyoti College of Engineering.
Yeah, ma'am, this is the classes you are giving through the session AVU is very good and useful and informative. And we have already started this GPS in our current going semester. And its response is very good from our students. Okay. And the idea of writing a research paper based on the methodology you suggested, that's really great. And I would like to ask a clarifying regarding writing a research paper, because the current semester, if we are implementing any of the methods like TPS, wiki, or a screenshot, or a flipped classroom method, can we make a research paper by taking the feedback from students and also collecting their perceptions based on the performance in assignments as well as test papers and their overall performance?
Okay. So the question is, if we do TPS or use wiki and all that, can we write a research paper based on students based on feedback related to student perceptions? So we discussed this today, and the idea, the quick answer is yes, but be careful. What do I mean by be careful? You have to think about what exactly is the research question you want to ask. Don't think of the measurement and metric right at the beginning, but ask yourself, for what purpose am I implementing TPS? What do I hope to improve by using a wiki? Once you get that point clear, then you can write your research questions which are aligned to the purpose that you want to improve. So if you want to improve students' learning, then think about various measurements you can do that show evidence of students' learning. And students' own perception of their own learning is one metric, but it's not the strongest metric. So if you can show, there is one point we didn't discuss today, and that point is called triangulation. It means you have multiple data sources to triangulate the same claim that you make. So suppose you make a claim that TPS helped improve students' conceptual understanding in a particular topic. And you showed data from both students' pre-post tests as well as students' perceptions. Then your claim is stronger because you have two sources of evidence. So think about using multiple sources of evidence for the same claim. If you only show standard course feedback saying that students like this technique, that is not evidence of improvement of students' learning. So if you choose to do this further, what I'd encourage you to do is look at the templates. Firstly, look at the paper called Guidelines for Writing, Reporting and Planning ET Research that's available on the website that I mentioned earlier. And it says there what to measure and how to measure and what is valid and what is not valid. Yeah. Orchid College of Engineering.
My question is related to 21st century teaching and learning.
Okay.
What is the difference between this learning pedagogy and 21st century teaching and learning pedagogy?
My first answer is we are in the 21st century and we are doing teaching learning methods that improve student learning and teachers teaching. So there is really, it's really one and the same thing. So that was really a joke. But I think what you are trying to ask is you've seen this word 21st century learning. You may have seen this phrase in certain places. And what modern day educators and researchers, ET researchers are trying to do is identify certain specific skills and items that is really important for students to learn today. So to give you one example, about 30 years ago, what was not very common, what was scarce was information. The internet was not there 30 years ago and students didn't have access to information. The only people who had access to information were experts and teachers. So information was what we wanted our students to get to know better, knowledge and information. But today, all students have ready access to content and knowledge and information. But what they need to learn is how to sift through this information, how to make sense of this, how to apply this information. So today, the focus should be really on how to help students acquire these skills, given that there is all such information. So if you see the phrase 21st century learning or 21st century skills, it's coming from this perspective. And even as domain-based teachers, engineering and science teachers in a classroom, what we want to help our students do is apply the information that we are teaching in the classes and the information that students are learning in order to solve problems. Okay, Center 1080, GRIET.
I have some previous experience in educational technology.
Okay.
And also I would like to do, I would like to do research. Basically, we are located at Hyderabad. Mm-hmm. So can we register PhD in ET technology in IIT Hyderabad or do you have any provision, madam, actually? Yeah, it is very difficult because I have done my PhD in electrical engineering. So we can only do research in either guide or do research or register in only electrical engineering. This is a new terminology.
Right.
Let us say somebody want to do research in ET technology, maybe with IIT. So
answer your question. So the question here is, what are options to do research in educational technology and especially at a PhD level? So right now, at IIT Bombay, we do have a department. It's called an interdisciplinary program, but it's a department of educational technology where we do have PhD research scholars. They have to go through the standard procedures of taking GATE, writing an entrance test, doing an interview and so on. But these people have masters in some discipline like science or engineering or other disciplines like psychology are also welcome. But their PhD research topic is in educational technology. So we do have a formal program here at IIT Bombay. Similarly, I believe IIT Kharagpur also has a similar program. SNDT University in Bombay has a program in educational technology and so on. So there are a few but not too many institutes in India which offer PhD programs in educational technology. Amrita University has a master's program in e-learning at the master's level and so on. So this is one answer, a formal answer to the question, what are options for research? But suppose you are a faculty member who's already doing research in electrical engineering, and let's say you already have a PhD in chemistry or engineering and so on. What are options? So here, I would like to repeat what I mentioned earlier. Start reading ET research papers and start participating in ET conferences. We have an IEEE international conference within India. It happens in different cities each year. And in 2015, it's in December. So you have a full year to participate in it. And this year, it's in NIT Warangal, in 2015. Look at the proceedings of the previous T4Es. And try to read them definitely. And try to come up with a research study, plan it and implement it during this year. That will at least get you a flavor of what is this kind of research. So again, this is to all engineering teachers and science teachers, also to other people who are interested in doing such research. Read the research papers and participate in the conferences. That is one first step. Let's go to Gnanamani College of Engineering.
Ma'am, my question is, while explaining about novelty, mm-hmm. many raised questions, how to find the solution for addressing diversity? Kindly give solution for addressing diversity, ma'am.
Okay, so again, this is a very challenging question. We have picked it up, I believe, in previous chats also. How do we address diversity? I can only make a few suggestions because this is not an easy question to solve at all. One solution is based on the techniques that we discussed in the workshop in the past few days. Suppose you implement something like peer instruction. Based on a comment that came at the beginning of this chat, let's say you're able to track which students are actually floundering, which ones are having trouble with the concept. If you will be able to track using a formal technique like peer instruction, because the technique itself will bring out students who are having difficulty. Then you can have extra classes or remedial classes for them. You can firstly just talk to them and try to find out why they're having difficulty. There is another technique called muddy points, and that is specifically targeting the issue of diversity. So what's done in muddy points is at the end of a class, you can do this either face-to-face or in Moodle. So in a face-to-face version, what you do is at the end of a class, you take a box and you have students write down on a chit of paper, give them very small chits of paper, not a full page, to write down one muddy point that they had. Muddy point is something that's not clear to them. And all students, it can be anonymous if you want, or you can have them write their names. Students write their muddy point and fold the chit and put it in the box. So what you will need to do, you or with the help of some of your colleagues, is go through the muddy points and classify them into different categories of questions. Some may be very advanced questions, some may be really basic questions. And you already now have a categorization of the diverse types of questions. In the following class, you actually address each category of questions. There is a paper related to muddy points in T4E 2013. And if you look at the IEEE proceedings, maybe we can, what we can do is upload this paper on Moodle. Okay. So how do you implement muddy points in a classroom? We'll upload this paper on Moodle, and that's one way to address diversity. Since this is a question which bothers a lot of people and many of you would have tried it, we'll also post this question in Moodle forum, and all other participants and other centers are welcome to respond how they address the question of diversity. That might give ideas.
Yeah, my question is related to the selection of the various tools which we have discussed mm-hmm. for a teaching learning environment.
Okay.
Is there any scientific rules formed already to select a suitable tool for the teaching learning environment?
So, quick answer to that is, first of all, the purpose of each task. So, for example, peer instruction works well when there is a conceptual level understanding problem between students and it gets elicited out of discussions with peers. Think, pair, share is useful when you want to discuss, do problem solving or discuss a larger problem where they are building up building up open-ended problems. Similarly, in case of tools, you can look at the learning activity that you want to use the tool for and use the digital Bloom's taxonomy to map the pedagogical purpose, the cognitive level of the task, and the features of the tool to use it appropriately for the learning activity that you want your students to do. So these are scientific decisions. I mean, at the end, these are all scientific decisions for each of the activities.
Okay. For higher order level learning, for scientific tools recommended by these rules for higher order learning,
yes,
outcomes?
Yes, it is recommended for all orders. So you see, lower order have some tasks or learning activities which you can do even with a simple recall or understand level questions. The only thing is, what we have taught throughout this workshop are activities which are meant for higher order learning. So in this workshop, you got familiarized with activities meant for higher order learning.
Okay, thank you.
Center 1118.
I have two questions. The first one is, in a large classroom, how do you take attendance quickly? Are there any methods you suggest?
So it depends on how much technology you have access to. The standard methods without technology, the ones that are used if attendance is compulsory, is passing around a sheet of paper or doing roll call. I mean, these are the two age-old standard methods which people have been using. But if you have access to technology such as clickers and all, that's another possibility. I mean, that's not something that we have worked on too much here.
The second question is, what is your comment on using a question bank to prepare the final exam question paper?
Okay, so let's try to look at this question a little bit more on, should we use a question bank to prepare a final exam paper, and if so, what should be inside the question bank and so on. So it could work in principle, provided the question bank itself is large enough and has categories of questions. So one thing we are trying to do through this workshop is actually get all of you to create a question bank of higher order Bloom's level questions in different topics, of peer instruction questions and so on. So if you have a question bank which is populated well, as in it has a large number of questions, and let's say the questions are tagged according to different Bloom's levels in a particular topic, that would be a useful resource for an instructor.
I have a suggestion, madam. I am trying to prepare a question bank in the wiki space where you have provided. What I would like to do is, based on the level, that is a thinking level, I will have a set of questions and indicate approximate time taken by the student to answer each question. Is it better to do like that, or do you suggest any other method of creating the question bank?
No, this is exactly what we were suggesting, that if your questions are tagged with the cognitive level, the topic, the subtopic, the purpose, whether it's a group activity or individual, time taken, you can make up various tags. The more tags it has, the more useful the information will be. Okay, Center 1036.
We are very fortunate to attend in this workshop. It is very effective, and we are getting hands-on experience, and we are sharing a lot of things in this. And now I'm coming to my question, ma'am. How to know the workload of a student? If all subjects are balanced, they can be more productive. Do you have any metrics in this regard, ma'am?
Okay, so the question is, how can we determine the workload of a student? And we don't have metrics like we did for technology enhanced learning effectiveness. So don't recall that there is something like that. As a teacher, if you're concerned about this, I mean, the one thing you can do is ask your students. And how do you ask them? Again, you can use something like a survey question or a peer instruction question in class. Give percentages, and you can ask whether the particular course you are teaching, how balanced is it with respect to other questions. Questions like this are meaningful to ask only if some action can be taken based on them. So if you think you can do some tweaks to your course based on your knowledge, then ask students diagnostic questions at the beginning, either handwritten surveys or PI surveys and so on. Center 1247.
I need to know if suppose we are dealing with first year undergraduate student who have been traditionally taught in their school, I mean in their intermediate school, are offering resistance or not lending themselves their interest towards new technology which we have learned here. I mean think, pair, share activity and all. What would be the step for us to motivate them towards this thing?
Okay. This is a very common problem among students also. That means you are not used to these kind of activities and you feel uncomfortable while you are doing collaborative activities. So a quick suggestion, make sure that there is sufficient incentive for the student to participate in the activities. So make sure you have, I believe that most of you have some amount of internal marks given to students. So let's say at the start of the session, you say that 5 marks out of the total or 3 marks out of the total internals will be given for the participation and engagement that you show in the class. So this is one kind of incentive. Another is make sure you practice, you do such activities continuously. So you may not get desired effect in the first or second TPS. You may have to do 5 or 6 TPS to actually see students collaborating and see that their levels are improving. So one thing that as your instructor you should have is patience and perseverance on the activities that you're doing.
What we have found from many instructors is these active learning strategies take a little bit of time initially to catch on, but it's usually within the third or fourth time you implement it, students get used to it and you will start seeing results in terms of large number of discussions and more people being engaged. So typically it's 3 to 4 times. The other thing you can do as a teacher is explain to students why you're doing them. That if they know that there is a reason which is related to their own improvement of learning and engagement, they're more likely to doing so. And if a larger number of colleagues of yours try it, then students will start seeing the same techniques being applied in multiple classes. So that also helps students feel that, you know, this is something routine. But do talk to them a lot. If you see the resistance, explain to them why it's happening and it's, yeah, instead of fighting it, we should try to get them on board as to why we are doing this. Again, this is one of those open forum questions that we can post and see what other people have tried that has worked. Center 1146.
I have 3 questions regarding sample size. Question number 1, is there any guideline for selecting the sample size? Okay. Question number 2, is the sample size context dependent? Question number 3, is a sample size has any relation for different parameters like effectiveness, attractiveness, accessibility and effectiveness? I mean, can we use the same sample size for all these parameters or should we use different parameters?
Okay, so question is related to how large should be the number of participants that you have in your research study. So we discussed several examples of research studies today morning and we talked about measurement, both the metrics, what to measure and how to measure. And one important choice you have to make, or sometimes you have constraints as to how many participants must I have. So one of the specific questions that was asked just now was, does it depend on context? And the answer is, yeah, it does depend not just on context, but also on the type of research you're doing. What I mean here is, suppose you are doing in-depth, rich interviews. You may only be able to do interviews of say 5 or 10 participants. And that's acceptable because you have a large volume of rich data. On the other hand, if you're doing multiple choice surveys, typically it's expected that you have a larger sample. So the focus is on the amount of data totally, whether it's in terms of richness of data, different types of data from the same participant, or you have lots of participants and you have more precise multiple choice type of data. That's one thing that will help you. The other thing is, suppose you're doing an experimental study with two or multiple groups, in order for statistical tests to be valid, there are some rules of thumb. Most statistical tests are not valid, things like t-test and chi-square tests and all. They're only valid beyond a certain sample size, which is somewhere around 25, 30, 35, 40 and so on. So unless, I mean, this is not the only constraint, but each statistical test comes with its set of rules and constraints on when you can apply it. So as guidelines, what we use is, suppose you have a smaller sample size. Let's say you have only 15 people and you have in one class. Don't do a two-group study. Do a pre-post study. Take multiple sources of data so that you have larger amounts of data for the 15 people. Try to analyze what are the limitations of your study because you have a smaller sample size. Be upfront about it in your research paper. And if you've done this systematically, the referee will be likely to accept it. On the other hand, if you have access to a larger number of students, let's say you have two sections and each student has 40 students, do think of a controlled group study in that case. Center 1075.
First of all, I am very much thankful that you have given a nice information on this educational technology. My question is that if any of the faculty from any domain, if it interested in doing the research on this educational technology, whether it will be accepted by any recognized university?
Okay, so this is a thorny issue. Is educational technology research accepted by universities, by AICT and boards and so on? So largely, right, currently AICT does not accept ET PhDs as relevant for the domain. So this is something you have to know if you are considering doing PhD in this. On the other hand, if you publish a research paper in an IEEE conference, for such as T4E, some universities, many universities are inclined to accept the paper. So you have, if this is going to be a problem for you, do check with your university. What we can say is many of these conferences and journals are highly ranked, they are part of IEEE Explore and so on. So being an engineering college, you can make a case that since it's part of IEEE Explore, it should be considered. On the other hand, for PhD, currently, the answer is most universities won't consider it seriously. So please be careful if you're considering this. We do have engineering college instructors registered for PhD, but they are aware of this issue today. Perumal College, Center 1061.
Ma'am, you have told about a lot of ICT tools for the past 6 days. Mm-hmm. And we have inquiry about the ICT tools. So if you can be able to list the priority of the tools from basic to advanced, because if we use the advanced tool the initial stage, it will be tougher for the average students to adapt the tools. So if we can able to give a preference of using those tools, it will be better for the faculty to use those tools in the classroom.
To answer this question, first of all, every tool has a purpose for which it has to be used. The Digital Bloom's taxonomy clearly says that you have to expose your learner to the tools first before actually using it in the classroom. So take your case as an example. Vicky, from the initial survey, we found that many of you were not aware of what a wiki is. So all the activities in the wiki was geared towards exposing you to the concept of wiki and making you practice in wiki, so that the next activity that we are going to give you are going to design, use wiki as a teacher. So the purpose of and why we use this, the purpose of wiki is that it can help you in collaboration. And collaboration is something that we have stressed throughout this workshop, and the content repository that we create, the creation of TPS questions or PI questions, require collaboration from each and every participant. Not just in submitting the PI and TPS questions, but also in reviewing the PI and TPS questions. So individually at our place, we'll not be able to review 4,000 TPS or PI questions. And hence, all of you were assigned some subset of these questions, and you were doing reviewing of these questions at your end and then posting them in the wiki. So this is how we have matched the purpose with the technology. So the same logic applies when you are using technology tools or ICT tools in your classroom, be it a simple one or an advanced one. RC10582, hear their question.
My question is related to students, collection of data from students. Mm-hmm. Now, when we collect this data and publish, should we inform students beforehand that we'll be collecting this information and we'll be publishing the data? What are the ethical issues in this?
So, okay, the question is, while you are collecting data from students, should we inform the students that we'll be using them for a research purpose? So the answer is yes, an informed consent is required. It is highly preferred that you do informed consent right before the start of the study.
So ethical issues, actually, there are number of subtle points here, because it depends on whether in your research, whether you are going to only publish an average of all the students' data, or you are going to publish individual data points, or you are going to try to identify a student with a data point, and so on. So the rules are fairly involved, but as a general guideline, what we should try to do is inform students that we are going to use the data to analyze what is happening. And especially if you are doing something like videotaping or interviewing and audio taping, then informed consent is a must. If you are using class averages, which are anyway going to be available, it's fine to tell them, but you may not need informed consent from each and every student at that point. When we do surveys and questionnaires, again, we do ask for informed consent. So what we will do is, again, different universities have different rules, different journals might have different rules. It's always better to err on the safer side if you're not sure. We can post a sample informed consent form on Moodle if you want to go ahead with this seriously. But the moment you have identifying data, video data, or if you're working with minors and children, then things, you have to be much more careful in those cases.
Another answer to the question is, we will be taking informed consent from all of you to use your data, I mean the assignments, the survey questions that you have answered, towards the end of the workshop. So you can actually look at the informed consent template that you will be getting at the end of this workshop, because we use this data to, first of all, improve the workshops that we are conducting. And secondly, it actually feeds into our own research on faculty professional development. So we will be specifically using the assignment data that you are having, and also the wiki data. So you can shortly see in the next session the survey question being put up, and the informed, you will be given an informed consent, a page on informed consent right at the start of the survey.
Okay, so let's end the session now. It's about 10 minutes to 1. We'll reassemble at 2 o'clock. Other questions do post on Moodle or chat. We'll try to get to all of you by the end of the workshop. And if we can't do live, then we'll definitely answer them on Moodle and chat. Moodle is going to be open for quite some more time, few more weeks. So we'll try to help you with all the questions. So let's reassemble at 2 o'clock.